Thank you all very much for coming here. I think the large crowd that's present here, in a sense, is a reflection of the times in which we live, because no institution has made as many front page headlines, faced the kind of intense scrutiny amid swirling controversies as the highest judiciary in the land. Suddenly, judges find themselves almost on a daily basis on the front page of newspapers. From the Chief Justice being sought to be impeached, to four sitting judges, including Justice Lokur holding a press conference, to judgments in politically sensitive cases, to tussles between the collegium and the government over judicial appointments and transfers, there hasn't been a dull day when it comes to the Supreme Court, which is why it is wonderful here to be joined by a judge who is a privileged insider, who is now an outsider. I won't call you to account, sir, because I believe when someone asked you just now at tea whether you could be questioned, you said, "I'm not here to be cross-examined." So we won't cross-examine you, Justice Lokur, but it is a great privilege to have you with us. And let me start by asking you that when you see almost on a daily basis judges and their judgments and their behavior and their character in some cases making headlines, how does it make you feel as someone who's spent a lifetime in the bar and the bench? Do you feel worried about it? Does it trouble you in the years that you were a judge? Did you look at the newspaper next morning worried that is my name going to make it to the front page or what? How is the fact of an institution suddenly finding itself under intense scrutiny, which was otherwise seen as a, you know, behind the four walls and the gates of the Supreme Court, the forbidding gates, now suddenly being subject to this scrutiny? Does it trouble you?
No, it doesn't trouble me at all. I think every institution should be under microscope. Why not? It doesn't trouble me at all.
You admit that every institution should be under a microscope. Why is it that this is said only when you retire? Why is it that sitting judges, when they are in the judiciary, appear to believe that they are not necessarily accountable to the bench?
The reason why I say this when I retire,
to the bar.
The reason why I say this when I have retired is, you didn't ask me this question.
Are you telling me that?
Yeah, if you had asked me when I was a judge, I would have said the same thing.
You know, let me turn to, since you seem to be more than willing, and you know, I take this as an opportunity to suggest that you want judges to be held accountable. Let's start with what exactly is the issue that has troubled many people. Let's come straight, cut the chase. December 12th, Collegium of the Supreme Court, comprising the Chief Justice, Ranjan Gogoi, yourself, three other judges, recommends the elevation of Justice Pradeep Nandrajot, Chief Justice of the Rajasthan High Court, Justice Rajendra Menon, Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court of the Supreme Court. January 10th, new collegium minus you, plus Justice Arun Mishra, now part of it, holds its first meeting, instead decides to elevate two other judges, Justice Dinesh Maheshwari and Justice Sanjeev Khanna. The details of your 12th December meeting are not even put up, the resolution is not even put up, uploaded on the website of the Supreme Court. How do you see it? Is it almost that we want to get rid of Madan Lokur and then we'll appoint new judges? That's the impression that many people are getting.
Well, I don't have that impression. Sorry, I don't have that impression at all. Well, there was a meeting on the 12th of December, undoubtedly, and certain decisions were taken, and that is reflected in the resolution of 10th of January. Now, what happened between 12th of December and 10th of January, I'm not
But does it leave you disappointed as a senior judge that decisions taken by the collegium, presumably through a process of consultation, are not as per practice put up on the website? Instead, they are reversed with only a cryptic line, additional material that has come to light. Were you informed of any of this additional material? Were you kept out of the loop? So you were kept completely out of the loop. Is it true that you asked the Chief Justice to upload that resolution on the 13th of December?
No, there's no reason to ask anybody to upload the resolution taken by the Collegium. It's something that is done. You see, the thing is, there's no there's no practice that is laid down, no standard operating procedure or something that is laid down. So once the resolution is passed, you know, I would expect in the normal course that it would be you know, put up on the website.
So does it leave you disappointed? Does it leave you disappointed as a senior jurist to find a decision that you've taken being almost overruled, if I may use the word, in the manner that it was, in complete opaqueness, with no transparency whatsoever?
It does disappoint me that it was not put up on the website, yes.
It does disappoint you.
Yeah, it does.
Does it also suggest that you fear that, I mean, that there could have been motives?
No.
Are you going to attribute motives? Are you going to...
No.
Have you tried to seek an explanation from the Chief Justice of the country?
That's not my job. No. That's not my job. The decision has been taken, and in the normal course it should have been put up. It was not put up. I'm disappointed. Why it was not put up is not my business.
It's not your business, but it's certainly, presumably, since you yourself say that judicial officers should be held to levels of accountability. It certainly concerns members of the bar. It concerns colleagues in the bench. Other judges have now written to the Chief Justice. You know, the manner in which it was done, is that at the heart of the problem that the institution remains trapped in opaqueness? What happens at that collegium meeting when five judges sit, the five wise men and women sit, is not known to the wider world when it should. It affects the careers of many people. It seems a totally subjective process. Do you agree with me?
Well, you know, what happens in the collegium is something which is done in confidence. And if I have a discussion with you, presuming you're a member of the collegium, it's obviously something which is in confidence. And I'm not going to betray anybody's trust and say that, well, this is what we discussed or this is not what we discussed. It's a matter of trust, it's a matter of confidence, and I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to betray these trustees. So we take certain decisions, and once we take certain decisions, they have to be uploaded.
Which is exactly it. You took a decision, yeah. It is not uploaded.
Yeah.
Two new judges are brought in. I'm sorry to persist.
Yeah.
I mean, I get a sense that you feel let down. Just a Lokur, you are now the outsider. You can say, you know, you can speak with a little bit more freedom than you did before the 31st of December.
I am telling you that I am disappointed. Yes, I am. I am disappointed that it was not uploaded. Yes.
Are you disappointed, therefore, that there is a lack of transparency as well in the way this entire process of appointment of judges is made in this country, which will, in the future also, perhaps, spark off similar controversies?
You see, let me just go back to this judgment of the NJAC.
Yes.
Now, among the things that was mentioned in the NJAC judgment is that there should be certain, you know, eligibility criteria, for example, right? How do you deal with complaints? That's one of the things that we have mentioned in the judgment. Suggestions were invited from the public, from the lawyers, from everybody. And if I remember correctly, something like 11,000 pages of suggestions were given, which were then analyzed to some extent by the then by the additional Solicitor General and by a senior advocate.
Yes.
Now, it was obviously a humongous task for us as judges to analyze all those 11,000 pages. And we were told by the Attorney General that the appropriate course, which we accepted, that the appropriate course would be for the Government of India in the Department of Justice or the Law Ministry or whatever to come out with a memorandum of procedure. And they did come out with a memorandum of procedure. Now that memorandum of procedure is silent in a sense on the you know, the details of the eligibility criteria. It does say, for example, that for the appointment of a judge to the High Court, the person should be 45 years of age. It does say that the person who will be recommended by the collegium of the High Court for appointment of a judge should have an annual income of 7 lakhs, right? But there are other things as well. You know, what is the standing of that person who is to be consulted, how is that person to be selected, and all that. The memorandum of procedure itself is silent on that. So really, when you talk about transparency in appointments, you know, the memorandum of procedure itself is silent.
Which is precisely the point.
Yeah.
Therefore, even after the NJC judgment, you're virtually back to a square one process where you know the notion of consultation, the notion of criteria is left sufficiently ambiguous. Today, Justice Nandrajog was here, or Justice Menon was here. They could well turn around and ask, you know, what is it that I, where did I fail? What is this additional material that has been provided? Should the Chief Justice of India not put that material out in the public domain if it is so serious to actually effectively bypass those two judges or overrule their appointment? Surely such material should is in the public interest and must be put out. How long will the judges, you know, almost sort of hide behind the MOP or hide behind the NJSC judgment?
Well, there is a material. I suppose somebody has to be trusted on dealing with the material, isn't it?
But should it be put out in the public domain, in your view?
I don't know. I'm not sure. You see, it depends on what kind of a material it is. Supposing it is something which is defamatory.
Yes.
You know, should the whole world know that, you know, it's defamatory? It could be something which is not defamatory, but may not be good enough to make that person a judge of the High Court. How does it matter?
You know, what surprises me, the material is good enough for them to continue as chief justices of their respective high courts, but is not good enough for them to be judges of the Supreme Court. What is so privileged that prevents a person who is the chief justice of two high courts of the required seniority, but you cannot be in the Supreme Court, sir?
Okay, so then, according to you, every chief justice should become a judge of the Supreme Court. Why not?
I said, sir, my limited point is once you've taken a decision in these two instances, then surely the material should be compelling enough and strong enough for that decision to be overruled. And if that material is compelling and strong enough, then A, either they're not fit enough to also be chief justice of the High Court.
Are
you saying there's a completely different level of...
Not necessary. A person may be a good chief justice, but may not be a good Supreme Court judge. How do you say that every chief justice is good enough to be a Supreme Court judge?
But presumably, sir, on the 12th of December, the five wise minds who sat in that room thought they were good enough.
Yes.
Suddenly on the 10th of January, they're not good enough.
But I was not there on 10th of January. So I don't know what was the additional material that the judges had.
Which is why the suspicion is that the Chief Justice was simply waiting for you to retire.
Yeah, that's for you to decide. Not for me. I don't know what the material was, so what can I say? I can't say anything about that.
Which is why we come back into the manner of transfer and appointments. You know, even at tea today, we had a couple of senior lawyers come to me and tell me about specific cases of specific lawyers whom the government wants to transfer out and others who they want to retain. The entire NJSC judgment therefore comes under scrutiny. You are among those who ruled in favor of the continuance of the system. There will be others today who will say, why not get honest and say the collegium system as it exists has failed? We need to find a better way to appoint and transfer judges. Do you at least accept that maybe the time has come to look at the way judges are transferred and appointed?
Well, I wouldn't say the collegium system has failed. I think that's a very, very strong word. I don't think it has failed. But yes, like every system, you know, it requires tweaking. All right, now, in the case of this Justice Karnan, for example, Justice Jalmekar and Justice Gogoi said that we need to revisit the method of appointment and selection of judges.
Yes.
There are things that happen, you know. It's not that, you know, the procedure is cast in stone and that's it. I mean, situations arise, we're dealing with human beings, we're not dealing with, you know, machines. So things happen and, certainly it needs tweaking. Yeah, it does.
Tell us how. I mean, you know, I will persist with this.
Yeah.
What happens inside a collegium? For all of us who are not privileged to be part of your collegium, tell us what actually happens inside. Is there intense debate or is it simply that sifarish pe chalta hai?
No. There's no sifarish in this. Well, there is a discussion.
There is no element of nepotism?
I don't think so.
No element of influence peddling in the years that you were in the collegium?
No.
Attempts made by whoever is the chief at the time to ensure that people who he or she may be close to get a better. Nothing's being equal.
It's like this. I think you have to understand a few things. If there is a suggestion that is given by the chief justice that I would like, or I think, that somebody should be appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court, or that somebody should be transferred out, well, we discuss it. Why should that person be appointed? Why should that person be transferred out? Should that person be transferred out? Should that person be appointed? So there is a discussion. Yeah, there is a discussion. It's not that because the Chief Justice says that, listen, this is to be done, therefore everybody agrees. It doesn't work like that. There is a discussion. There is a healthy discussion. There are agreements. There are disagreements. If the Chief Justice says, I think a particular person should be appointed, well, I may disagree. And he may accept my appointment. If he doesn't, well, I'm entitled to say, as a member of the police, that listen, I don't agree with you.
But how would you, if you had an opportunity now to revisit the collegium system and think of a better way in which public confidence, the confidence of the bench and the bar was restored in the manner in which transfers and appointments are being made, what according to you would be a better system than the one that exists today? Today it seems the primacy of the Chief Justice. The Chief Justice seems to have a certain element of privacy.
No, I don't think so. The Chief Justice is the first amongst equals, right? There's no difficulty about that. So the discussion is initiated by the Chief Justice, right? And as one of the equals, I am entitled to disagree with the Chief Justice like anybody else. It's not that because the Chief Justice says so, therefore I must agree with him. Right? It doesn't work like that.
But should there be no accountability of the collegium at all? What is the accountability today of the collegium? What is the accountability?
What is the kind of accountability that you are looking at?
I come back to the latest instance. Additional material, according to the resolution drafted on January 10th, has been responsible for two judges being passed over and two other judges being appointed. You were part of the collegium. Either that additional material possibly was available before December 31st. If it was, surely you should have been informed of it.
Right.
You are telling me you were never informed of any additional material.
Right.
Therefore, the additional material very conveniently could see came between the 1st and the 10th. If that material has come, should we be satisfied with just what has been said in that resolution? Or should I or any member of the bar or bench not have the right to ask, please put that material in the public domain? And if it is serious enough, please tell us how serious it is. I mean, I'm just saying, there seems to be a complete lack of transparency in the process. So where is the accountability when there is no transparency, sir?
Yeah, you see, again, we're coming back to the same thing, What is the kind of material that was there before the collegium on the 10th of January? You don't know, right? I assume you don't know. I don't know. Now, supposing it was something which is incorrect,
yes,
and defamatory, right? The collegium believes it to be correct,
yes,
okay, and it's defamatory. Do you expect them to put it out and say that listen, this is defamatory material?
But it leaves the space for a lot of gossip, for a lot of innuendo, which is the last thing people at the highest in the country's highest judiciary need. I mean, let's be honest, that's really what is triggering off a lot of the there's a lot of speculation over the manner in which judges at the moment are being appointed and transferred. I was just given an example just now of an advocate who was to be brought to the Allahabad High Court as a judge. Three times you've sent his recommendations to the government. The government apparently has returned it three times. Again, we don't know why. In the case of Justice Joseph, where you had a conflict with the, you were part of the collegium, you are conflicted with the government returned it back twice, eventually he was elevated. But the manner in which it happened, don't you think it undermines public faith in the institution?
Yeah, this is precisely what I'm saying, that there is a need to bring about a change. Right? And this, what you have mentioned, is one of the examples for bringing about a change. Now, the memorandum of procedure, for example, is silent on many of these things. Let me give you an example. It says that if the High Court Collegium makes a recommendation and says that we think that so-and-so should be appointed to judge, and the state government does not respond, all right, or does not act upon that recommendation within a period of 6 weeks, then the government of India, the Law Ministry or the Department of Justice, whoever is concerned, can proceed on the assumption that they have no objection. Okay? Now, supposing the government of India or the Law Ministry or the Department of Justice does not proceed on that assumption, what happens? And this has happened in several cases, you know, where the files have remained pending with the government for months together. So what is the sanction, you know, so to speak, for inactivity? Supposing the government sits on the file for months together, it sat on the file of Justice KM for months together.
That's right.
What do you do? The memorandum of procedure is silent on that. Now, what do you expect any to be? Perhaps just, you know, maybe the Chief Justice to ring up to find out what's happening. You know, apart from that, what else? They will say, yeah, if the file is with us, we process it.
Has that been your experience that when convenient the government will sit on a file? Let's be again honest now. You are outside the system. Particularly what we've seen in the last year or two. The government sits on files when it suits them.
Well, I don't know whether it suits them or not, but everybody knows that the government has been sitting on some files. It's a matter of public knowledge. It's not something to do with my being a member of the collegium or not. Everybody knows it. Files have remained pending for a couple of months. Everybody knows it.
So what should be the role of the government then?
Yeah, so therefore there has to be some mechanism, you know, if you want to improve the system, and I think the system needs to be improved, there has to be some mechanism by which the timelines which are laid down must be strictly adhered to, or else, you know, it should be taken as a consent. Right? That's one way of looking at it. You know? Or maybe there should be some discussions or something between whoever is there in the government and the members of the collegium or the Chief Justice or somebody.
Because the other view would be that the government doesn't want inconvenient judges but would prefer pliable judges. Because that's again, it's about how the public perceives it. It's about perception.
Yes, certainly. Could be. Yeah.
You accept that?
It could be.
That's the perception of
it. It's not a question of my accepting perception or not. Have a perception, but it could be that the government might sit on the file because it doesn't want a particular person. It's possible.
Is that what happened with Justice Joseph?
I don't know whether the government wanted him or didn't want him. Ultimately, he was appointed. So it was only a question of time.
You are literally pushed then?
Well, I don't know. I can't say that.
You know, the reason again I come back, and this is where, you know, therefore the people, you know, there will be those who will say maybe the NGH AC majority judgment was flawed. You know, you and others seem to refer almost to suggest as if appointment of judges is part of the basic structure of the Constitution.
Yeah.
There are others who would suggest that is hardly the basic structure of the Constitution. We need a wider process of consultation before appointing judges.
Yeah. Sorry.
And maybe that would include the executive.
Sorry. You know, I have said that the view has been taken in the NGAC judgment. I think that the view is correct, that there must be an independent judiciary, right? I also think that the collegium system is, in the existing circumstances, the best system. But I also say that the collegium system, existing collegium system, needs some tweaking. What is that tweaking is something that all of us need to discuss, you know? We can't just say that, listen, because there has been a problem on one occasion, therefore you throw the collegium system out. Alright? There have been problems in the pre-collegium system as well. Right? So you throw that out. You bring in the collegium system, you throw that out. You bring in a third system. Something happens, you throw that out. How long is this going to go on?
You're saying define the memorandum of procedure more clearly.
Yeah.
Specify the criteria, have a time limit. The law minister of the country cannot simply sit on a file, and if he sits on a file beyond a prescribed period of time, nobody can sit on a file, it will be taken as consent.
That's one way of looking at it. Yeah, that's one way of looking at it, certainly. Nobody can sit on a file, and that includes, you know, not only the government, it also includes the judiciary.
I'll come back to this in a moment, but, you know, the entire controversy was triggered, you know,
not this specific controversy, but the role of judges. When you had that historic quote-unquote press conference in January of 2018, in hindsight, what did that press conference achieve? Was it simply about questioning the authority of the Chief Justice to be the sole master of the roster? Was it about administration of justice, or was it about something more? 13 months later or 12 months later, I'm not sure what you really achieved with that press conference. Was it really worth it?
Was it worth it?
I'm asking you, sir.
Well, I think it was worth it. Yeah, why not?
What did you achieve? What was the intent and what did you achieve?
Well, what did we achieve? I don't know. I can't specify what exactly we achieved, but I'm sure we achieved something. Some little bit of openness. A little bit of openness in the system. Yeah.
You just put the Chief Justice on notice. I mean, let's be honest, administration of justice, the manner in which cases are assigned, there is a sense that this has been, you know, there have been previous Chief Justices who also faced similar criticism. What is it that, in this particular instance, led you to take what many believe, the Fali Narimans and the Soli Soravji said, if you had to sort it out, sort it within the confines of the court, four judges should not have gone out in the public. What would you like to tell the Soli Soravjis and the Fali Narimans of the world?
Well, I don't want to tell them anything.
Why not?
No, why should I? But we did have a discussion with the Chief Justice about some issues. And when we did not get a positive response, time and again, not once, not twice, but more than two or three times, well, we thought that it would be appropriate to let people know that we have a different perception from what the Chief Justice has.
You're telling us something important. What you're saying is that this was not a one-off, this was something that was building up over a period of time. You did make the attempt of reaching out to the Chief Justice, Justice Mishra then. He didn't, in a sense, accept perhaps your grievances, so you thought there was no choice but to go to the court of the public.
Not to the court of the public, but if you remember, we circulated a letter which had been sent to the Chief Justice.
Yes.
Right? That contains everything. Okay? So when we when we wrote that letter, when we voiced our views, and that letter, if I remember correctly, was sometime in October. It was in October, and when we came out in January, so there was time a little bit before October, then October, November, December, then January.
How have things changed? Because
it has brought about some openness, yes.
It has brought about openness?
Yeah, I think so, yes, certainly, yeah, it has. It has.
You know, the argument that critics of your action make is that if you really had to go and take this extreme step, according to some, of going and addressing a press conference, then go on the real issues, go on judicial corruption, expose the corruption of the judges. You know, to go on administration of judges, administration of justice is the low-hanging fruit.
Give me the names of those judges who are corrupt. Give me the names. You're talking about corruption of judges. Give me the names.
I give you the names in this gathering. You will, your fellow judges will throw the contempt of court, which again comes backward of judicial accountability. Let's be honest.
One minute.
I'll give you an example, sir. A few years ago, we came very close to stinking a judge of the Supreme Court.
Truth is a good defense. So if you have the name of any judge who's corrupt,
you see, I will leave that Prashant Bhushan at some stage.
Allahabad High Court, your court has sent a recommendation for his impeachment.
Sorry?
Justice Shukla of the Allahabad High Court. Your court has recommended his impeachment. What happened to that?
The then
Chief Justice, the sir,
If I remember correctly, this is what my impression is, that there is an in-house inquiry.
Yes.
Right? Now, that in-house inquiry has to be dealt with by the Chief Justice. Okay, so I'm not aware of what was the result of that in-house inquiry, And if the in-house inquiry is concluded, I believe it is concluded. I have no idea what the Chief Justice has done for it. I have no idea.
Prashant, do you want to take up the challenge? It has been suggested here by Justice Lokur. Name the judges, right? That's effectively what you're saying. You must name the judges.
See, the point is that, for example, there is a recently publicized case of Chief Justice of a High Court who's being considered for elevation to the Supreme Court. The reports in the media and the documents that I have seen suggest that a then sitting judge of the Supreme Court was asked for his opinion about that particular judge. And in his opinion, he said that, look, he appears to have acquired these six properties after his being appointed a judge, which appear to be of considerable value. There are very serious allegations that he has undervalued them. They need to be properly valued. He also said that there are serious allegations of his taking cash for bail. Here are 9 orders that he has passed on bail which do not appear to be above board. This matter also needs to be examined, and there are other serious allegations which need to be investigated. Now the point is that there is nothing which shows that any investigation took place on those allegations made by a sitting judge of the Supreme Court. And yet we learn from the media that that judge is being considered for appointment to the Supreme Court. Now, it's not a question of, mostly one does not have evidence or hard evidence of corruption of a judge. One occasionally gets some evidence sometimes. But when no investigation takes place, when people make complaints and no investigation takes place on that, that raises very serious questions.
You know, are we saying therefore that this entire system by which, let's assume that there are allegations of corruption, and then you've got to go through a long drawn out process that will eventually, after investigation, possibly lead to impeachment. And we've seen all too few in this country happen. Do you believe that that system also needs to be looked at? That we need perhaps a swifter, more transparent system that doesn't prevent judges from doing their work honestly, but also punishes the dishonest. I mean, let's be honest, hundreds of judges across this country, there must be several of them, sir, who aren't of the highest integrity. And yet, you know, they perhaps get away. Do you believe the system needs to be reviewed for looking at cases of judicial corruption rather than leaving it for gossips in the corridor of the courts?
Yeah. If there is evidence of corruption or strong not necessarily evidence in that sense, but enough to show that a person is not honest. There should be a system, and we need a faster system, certainly.
So that we be more direct, do judges protect their own?
No, I don't think so.
Sir, the former Chief Justice of India was indicted for land fraud.
No, let's look at the specific. Do you believe that judges protect their own? And therefore, even that system needs to be reviewed in some form.
You know, I don't know what you mean by protect their own. I mean, if a person is guilty, he's guilty. What is the question of protecting somebody who's guilty? Right? If the person is innocent, he's innocent. He doesn't need any protection because he's innocent. Now, what you are saying, I suppose, I don't know what you're trying to say. What you are saying is that if in a gray area, perhaps the judges are trying to protect somebody.
No, what I'm saying is that there are numerous, you know, Prashant Bhushan raises one particular instance, but over the years, there have been several such instances. In some cases, you're right, the evidence may not be of 100%, but it's surely worth pursuing and investigating. Do you believe this process of investigating a judge who may be accused of corruption is pursued with a due seriousness, or is there an attempt at the end of the day to play it down, to not take it as seriously as it should?
Okay, let me tell you about my own personal experience.
Yes.
There was an allegation against a particular judge of corruption. Okay. I happen to be a member of that in-house committee to look into the allegation of corruption, and we did find that the judge was corrupt, or the corrupt in the sense of dishonest. So we did make a recommendation to the Chief Justice. So it's not that, you know, these things don't happen. Now, what the Chief Justice did after that, I don't know. That was entirely for the Chief Justice to decide. But if there is some material that a person is corrupt or believed to be corrupt, or believed to be dishonest, or believed to lack integrity, there is a procedure. You know, and I can't tell you offhand how long it took us for that inquiry, but I think the inquiry was conducted fairly fast.
The proximity of judges to the government, sir.
Yeah.
You know, there was a belief that judges kept away from government and government officers and their functions to the maximum extent possible. Now there's a sense that some of those walls are being breached. The Prime Minister attended, I think not too long ago, a dinner that the judges told. You know, Norm, you invite him by convention, but the Prime Minister doesn't attend. Not only did he attend, but apparently he asked you to open the doors of court number one and wanted to see how the court proceedings take place. Do you believe that the distance must be complete and total between government and the judiciary?
I don't know what you mean by, you know, distance should be complete. I mean, are you suggesting that I should not see the face of the Prime Minister?
So there are photographs of some judges who attend, let's say, the you know, the wedding of a politician's son or daughter, and then the photographs come out. Should the judge be a hermit completely? Once you become a judge of the Supreme Court,
I don't think a judge should be a hermit. I don't think this ivory tower business is correct. That a judge should be in an ivory tower. If judges are going to be in an ivory tower, you don't know what the hell is going on at the town level. Why should a judge be a hermit? You know, on the one hand, you talk about, you know, judges being human beings. And on the other hand, you say he should be a hermit. Or he should be sitting in an ivory tower, or he should not know what's happening. I mean, it can't be like that, you know.
The doors of the Supreme Court opening specifically for the Prime Minister?
That's perfectly okay. I don't think there's anything wrong in that. I think you're reading far too much into it. You must know that this was in a conference in which judges, Chief Justices of some other countries had come. There was a dinner. I don't think there's anything wrong in inviting the Prime Minister for a public dinner. I don't think there's anything wrong. The Prime Minister of India gives a favor to the Chief Justice of India, the outgoing Chief Justice, and a welcome to the incoming Chief Justice. The President does it. Now, are you trying to say that we should not have this sort of a thing? I mean, that's stretching it too far. You know, I'm sorry, but that's stretching it too far.
Post-retirement assignments,
yeah,
that are, you know, that seem to be the practice. Do you believe that judges must accept appointments almost immediately? You know, we've even had judges becoming governors. Chief Justice is now becoming governors. Do you believe a line needs to be drawn somewhere?
Yeah, it does.
As to what it does need to be drawn.
Certainly.
What should be the line?
Well, it depends on a variety of factors. For example, you have the National Human Rights Commission, all right? The law says, the law enacted by Parliament, says that the chairman of the National Human Rights Commission will be a retired Chief Justice of India.
Mm-hmm.
Now, supposing all the Chief Justices say that, listen, we are not going to become chairman of the National Human Rights Commission, do you think that body can function? The law says that the chairman of the Central Administrative Tribunal will be a retired Chief Justice of the High Court. Supposing all the Chief Justices of all the High Courts, they are not going to become presidents or chairman or whatever it is of the Central Administrative Tribunal. Do you think it's going to work? So you have laws, right? And if the law requires that a person, that a retired judge or a retired Chief Justice should be a member of a particular body, change the law. You know, you can't say that, oh, because you become a member, there's something wrong with that.
No, but governors, members of parliament, the kind of post that has, would you accept if the government gave you a governorship?
I would not.
If they made you a Rajya Sabha nominated member?
I would not.
The reason I'm asking you this
is
also...
rumor that I'm going to become...
No. The reason I'm asking you this is because look at the number of cases with a political... with a distinct political flavor that the judges have to, in a sense, deal with. Look at the Mandir Masjid dispute which is coming up, sir. Look at other sensitive cases that have come up in the past. Dare I say some contentious. I know there will be people who still ask a question as to the stand that you took on the Birla Sahara diaries that the judiciary took at the time. or the Kaligopul case. You know, the Arunachal chief minister's widow who came before the Supreme Court. I'm just asking, given the nature of these cases, that by their very nature, look at the CBI director's appointment case, sir. Chief Justice Gogoi has suddenly recused himself. Now that leads to questions being asked as to why he chose to do what he did.
Why?
Because the same Chief Justice, sir, chose to adjudicate on Alok Verma's case. But when it comes to Nageshwar Rao, suddenly says, I want to recuse myself because I am responsible for the, I'm part of the committee which will appoint the next CBI director. That argument could well have been used when Alok Verma's case came before him.
Alright, supposing it wasn't. What are you suggesting? That he should have heard the case and taken up a meeting tomorrow?
No, I'm saying he could have recused himself from the original Alok Verma hearing.
He did not. Alright, now therefore what? Therefore what?
So my point is...
Therefore he should hear the case and also be in the election committee.
But you know, it's very interesting. So the selection committee was as a result of a judgment passed by the late Justice Verma. And we've seen with successive CBI directors, all of whom have been appointed by a collegium of which the Chief Justice is a part, each of them, at least three of the last four, have been in some way or the other accused of serious corruption. What does it say about the system when the leader of the opposition, the Prime Minister and the Chief Justice of this country cannot appoint men of integrity to the highest post or against whom then subsequent allegations come up? I'm just wondering whether the Chief Justices of this country or senior judges want to spread their reach well beyond the judicial domain to what is essentially a political domain and thereby find themselves getting into one controversy after the other. What does the Chief Justice now do in a situation like the CBI director?
I don't know what he will do and I don't advise him.
No, I'm looking at judicial overreach, sir. Do you believe that in a certain area judges should simply stay out? Whether it's the Rafael case, possibly?
No. Well, listen, I'm not talking about any specific case. Please don't get into that.
Yeah, but in generality.
Yeah, in generally, yeah, I think the judges, the judiciary has to stay out of the political thicket. And that's very well accepted. It's not only something from India, but it's all over the world. Stay away from the political thing.
Do you feel it?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. So, you will have, for example, in the United States, Bush versus Gore, for example. Right? There was a lot of controversy. Now, it may have been a simple case of, whatever that ballot and all that was. It may have been political, I don't know. You know, I'm sure those people know. But I don't know. But yeah, if it comes to the political ticket, judges have to stay out. That's not their job. Judges are not politicians.
But look at whatever they do with this Mandir Masjid case, sir, will have a political implication.
Yeah,
should they have stayed out?
I'm not talking about any particular case. I don't want to go into any particular case. There are cases pending.
You're even administering cricket and making a mess of it. The the committee of administrators has messed up Indian cricket. I'm just wondering whether the Supreme Court needs to take a step back, sir. Is this the time for us, the Supreme Court, to take a step back and say, let's focus on the core issues where justice is involved, rather than get involved in sundry other activities where really you don't need a judicial review?
I'm repeating what I have said, that I do not want to discuss any particular case, whether it's the BCCI or whatever. I don't want to discuss any particular case, but yes, there are occasions when judges have gone beyond what is required, right? So on those occasions, they certainly do need to step back, certainly. I think it's with every branch of democracy, the executive sometimes oversteps. Okay, so the judiciary strikes down the actions of the judiciary. Parliament sometimes oversteps, or the legislature sometimes oversteps. The courts say that it is unconstitutional. Now, to say that it's overreach in that sense, if you're using the word overreach as a very strong term, I don't think that's right. The legislature can make a mistake, can misunderstand powers. The executive can misunderstand its powers. The judiciary can misunderstand its powers. But to say that, well, because you have misunderstood your powers, therefore it's overreached, I don't think that's a fair criticism.
Have you retired on December 31st with a sense of feeling content?
Oh, yes.
About the state of the judiciary? You know, you passed remarkable judgments in the context of the environment, the Juvenile Justice Act. You made a genuine effort to sort of reach out to those who need justice more. But do you believe the system, the institution, is functioning as well as it should? Or are you depressed when you read the newspaper headlines and the editorial opinion about the state of the judiciary?
No, I'm not depressed. But like I said from the beginning, I said that certain things need tweaking, right? And we need to discuss those things. It's not only the collegium. But justice delivery, the entire system of justice delivery needs tweaking. You know, I mean, like, what about, appointments? Should we have, 20,000 judges, or should we have 50,000 judges? Or should we have 1 lakh judges? You know, I think we need to discuss these things, you know. And unfortunately, we are not discussing many of these things.
Speedier justice,
we are not discussing it. You know, we've got cases which are pending for many years. How do we expedite justice delivery? How do we make it more accessible to the people? You know, we need to discuss all that. So I think there are a large number of issues which need to be discussed, where things need to be tweaked. And I think we should get on to the job. Yeah. And if you make a mistake, step back.
I'll come back for a few closing comments, but let's open it up and get questions. If there's a mic around, then it'll be easier. We won't make it a cross-examination, don't worry. Why don't we start this side? Yes, ma'am.
Not answering that.
Okay, let's get into yes, I think there are
quite distinguished senior counsels.
Yes, please, please.
As well as members of the press, both of which have had sufficient access or get officials of access to Justice Lokur. There are other junior members of the bar here, advocates, non-lawyers, who never ever have an opportunity to ask a question to.
Please identify them. Very good.
So before we start with the questions from the press and the senior members of the bar, may I just request the junior members of the bar, not citizens, they can ask. Please don't ask any questions in regards to existing cases. Please don't ask any questions that will be inappropriate. But please make the best of this opportunity to ask a question to Justice Lokur. Because since the time I started my judicial career, he's the one who's been asking questions to me. And I'm sure that any of us would be around here. So please get a chance to ask.
And we've assured him it's not a press conference. So the press has been kept out.
So the first few questions.
You'll have to make one exception for me. I'm not a junior member, but exception.
Yeah, but go ahead. Jason is exception.
Is coming.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
We want to get young lawyers to ask questions.
Introduce yourself.
I am one year old in the bar, and I would like to ask President Secretariat confirm me that yes, we have indeed received a letter from the then C Chair Mishra seeking impeachment of Justice Narayan of Lower High Court. So I am confirming you that yes, it is confirmed that he has indeed written a letter seeking impeachment of Justice Narayan of Lower High Court because in our inquiry impacted him. It has been a year. But the government of India is sitting over it and it has not even circulated a letter to the member of parliament to suggest us what is the day of.
That's a pretty long question in the proper answer. Yeah, anyone else? Is someone from the other side of the press cameras, this entire room, anyone else?
I have a question, I'm sorry. My question is this. You said the post retirement assignments and there are statutory commitments. But how these post-retirement assignees are chosen, in the sense how they are selected? Because we have got so many chief justices, I'm told that this offer is not given to many of those people. Like so many other posts, this offer is not given to many of the chief justices. So how this selection takes place?
I don't know how concerned ministry would write to the Chief Justice of India if it's something to do with the government of India. Or if it is something to do with the state, then it would write to the Chief Justice of the High Court, saying that there is a vacancy of a member of the state administrative tribunal or something, and you know, would you like to recommend some person? This is what my impression is. When I was Chief Justice of Guwahati or Andhra Pradesh, I never got any such request, so I'm not sure about it. But I would imagine that this would be the procedure, and then the Chief Justice would make a recommendation.
Okay. Yeah. There's one gentleman right here.
Yeah.
Yes.
Go ahead. I just want to know why judges are, you know, so unapproachable by commoners like us. And then I'll just add to that is that there was a situation at the end of last month where the newspapers have reported that the Meghalaya rescue operation was hindered because there were no pumps to take out the water. So we tried to move a petition during the vacation, and of course the vacation registrar said that it's not urgent in our opinion, and therefore we wrote to you on an email to Mr. Sharma, and of course I also wrote to the Chief Justice, but nothing happened. And the next day we were told that your mail went to the Secretary General, and he also just responded by saying that nothing can happen on it because it's not urgent. So in a situation like this, where does a common person or a lawyer go?
You know, I think if you go back into history, there was a time when letters were sent to judges, and judges then took up those cases as you know, public interest litigation. Then I think it was decided, I can say about the Delhi High Court. I believe it's the same that applies to all other high courts, including the Supreme Court. That if a letter like this comes, then it has to be placed before the Chief Justice. The Chief Justice has a committee, right? I was a member of the committee of the Supreme Court, where a letter would come. I didn't get more than maybe two or three letters to see whether that letter could be considered as a PI. Okay, so there is a procedure that is to be followed. Now, in your case, you followed that procedure in the sense that you went to the registrar, which you have to during the vacation, and then you went to the Chief Justice. Now, it's for the Chief Justice to take a call on this. I think he decides himself, because it's a vacation, there's no committee meeting. So, well, that's it, you know, but there's nothing more that I can say about the procedure. It's not that I can say that, listen, you know, I disagree with the Chief Justice, and I think because this was written to me, therefore, it's an important matter. It would be chaos in that sense.
Yes, one more question. Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir. I'm also a practitioner.
Please come forward. Come forward.
The question is, do you think that ought to be a bench of the Supreme Court outside of Delhi as well to be
more justified yourself, please?
Well, I'll tell you, a long time back, I was in Pakistan, and in Pakistan they have their benches in different parts of the country. They have a bench in Lahore, they have a bench in Rawalpindi, they have a bench in Madan, they have a bench in Peshawar. And I asked one of the judges, who is now presently the Chief Justice of Pakistan, I said that you know, in a country like India, should we have benches? What is your experience? And what he told me was, he said, don't even think about it. So the experience is not, it appears that the experience in Pakistan is not very good. And if you go by that experience, it may not be such a great idea to have benches in different parts of the country.
This is one question right next to you. Yes.
Just
come forward, introduce yourself, please.
Good evening, sir. So my name is Priyansha Sharma. I want to ask, sir, which judgment or case has given you maximum satisfaction as a judge? There must be something.
You protected the Taj before the UP government decided one day to demolish it.
Well, you know, one judgment I think which has given me a lot of satisfaction actually is about widows in Vrindavan. You know, that I think is a judgment which has not, you know, been highlighted, so to speak. But the condition of widows in Vrindavan was pathetic. It was really, really pathetic. And I'm glad I could do something about it. And I'm very glad that the officers in charge did something about it and did something very remarkable about it. I think because those are, you know, those widows that have been shut out of their homes or whatever, educated people, educated women. So I would rate that pretty high on my list.
Sir, you were in Pakistan last weekend. One of the things that we saw with the previous Chief Justice there is how Pakistan, the Supreme Court's really treaded on this judicial populism, so to say. Are we seeing the danger of being there someday? Or if we already are there, do you see a way out at all?
No, I don't see any danger of our Supreme Court going to that extent. So the second part of your question doesn't arise. I don't think what would go to that extent. Please, I hope they don't.
The state of activism in our court is not...
Yeah, you see, it's like this, which I told him also, that sometimes there is, you know, you overstep the boundary.
One of the most progressive pronouncements on the right to information actually came from the Supreme Court, and long before the law was passed. And the court held famously that sunlight is the best disinfectant. Even following the discussions that happened today, why is it that you feel that for the judiciary that principle would not hold? Because what we are finding is that the right to information law also covers the judiciary. But when people are asking questions about the assets and liabilities of judges, they're asking questions about the correspondence between judges where there might be pressure that might be borne upon sitting judges, or they're asking about appointments using the right to information law. All of this information is being systematically denied by the courts. And in fact, there was a constitution bench which all of these matters was referred to about 9 years ago, and that bench hasn't been set up till date. So why is it that the judiciary is different?
Well, I think that the constitution bench will have to decide. The Delhi High Court has taken a view, I think the view has been staked by the Supreme Court. The Constitution bench will have to take a part in that.
But should the assets and liabilities, in your view, of judges be out in the public domain? And if someone through an RTI asks about them, they should be made available. What's your personal view?
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, when I was a judge of the Delhi High Court, when I was a judge of the Supreme Court, I did disclose my assets and liabilities.
Do you think all judges should do the same in an ideal world?
In an ideal world, yes.
An ideal world is the real world.
The ideal world is the real world?
Should be. It should be. We should look like, yes, the
doctor. Yes, good evening, just good evening, sir. My question is about the seed and all loves that are doing rounds right now, or the controversy around it. Given that you handle sensitive cases such as Muzaffarpur, there were sealed documents that were necessary to be filed, or there were documents necessary to be filed in a sealed envelope, because it was all the witnesses about the scrolls and everything. But now we also have instances such as Anand Tatumbe's case, where a whole judgment by the High Court has been delivered on the basis of a sealed envelope, and it was not even given to him, and it is materially incriminating him. So what is your view on sealed envelope?
You see, I don't know about this case that you're talking about. I don't know what happened in any other case. I can tell you about what my experience is. What I did while I was on the bench. In the whole bench, for example, we took reports from the CBI in a sealed cover only for the purpose of seeing that the investigation was going on in the right direction and they were not, you know, beating about the bush. And wherever it was necessary to disclose what was there in the sealed cover, we disclosed it. You know, it's not that we kept anything back and nobody, none of the lawyers ever told me or told any one of us in the bench at any point of time that we were holding something back. So the purpose of the sealed cover was only to see that the investigation goes on in the right direction. Similarly, with the rapes that were committed in Muzaffarpur, again, the idea was to ensure that the investigation does not go in a direction which it should not. Now, during the course of the investigations, the CBI did find, things about rape and sexual abuse and so on and so forth. but that was only as a matter of fact. So that was again just to find out that yeah, this thing has happened and the investigation is going on. But what was the nature of the sexual abuse and all that? That was not a part of the seat cover. So as far as I'm concerned, and the bench of which I was a part of, which I presided over, we looked at seat covers only for the purposes of seeing that the investigation is being conducted in a fair and impartial manner and is not being, it is not a cover up or something.
We just have another 5 minutes, so just a couple of questions, very quickly.
Question regarding the judges' freedom of speech. Sometimes judges give very strange remarks. Recently, a judge, High Court judge, said, reduce the entire history of India into a paragraph, and it is similar to what we read on WhatsApp forwards. So, what is the responsibility or accountability of when they make such comments which have an impact on the media and on the people?
Okay, I can't answer that question.
Please tell the gentleman me again. Dinesh, you asked your one question.
Yes. You've been part of collegiums, and for the past 8 years, the Supreme Court has not seen a judge from the Dalit community. Now, here, collegium after collegium, I mean, the Supreme Court articulates the concept of social justice very well in its judicial pronouncements. But why is it that when the collegium sits for elevating people, you tend to overlook people from the marginalized minorities? Is that, do we say that for 8 years you have not been able to find a single judge from the Dalit and Adivasi community to sit on the bench?
No, you see, seniority is one criteria, right? Now, at the time when I was there in the collegium, there was no judge who was senior enough or who had that requisite seniority to, you know, be considered. I mean, you can't say that.
You
know, because
we just
superseded
30 judges.
No, absolutely. Please don't ask me.
That was something that I was not a member of that region. Well, you can't say that a person, because he's say 70 or 80 or 90 or 100 in the seniority, and he happens to belong to a particular community or belongs to a particular region, therefore he can jump over everybody. That means seniority has no role, but.
He does make a good example that when now two judges have been appointed, overruling the collegium judgment that you took, over 30 judges have been superseded. Again, it's coming down to arbitrariness. The worry with the collegium system, which you've defended very strongly today, is that there is a built-in arbitrariness to it until rules are framed in a more transparent manner.
This is, I've been saying the same thing for such a long time.
Yes.
That it needs to be tweaked.
Sorry, does it need to be tweaked or revamped or overhauled?
Well, take out the thesaurus, whatever you want
to use. But it needs to change. It's not. It cannot be as it is now.
It's not that it needs to change, but it needs to improve. Now,
The example of the last one, I'm trying to get my news point.
Yeah.
The example of the last one clearly suggests that the collegium system can result in an element of arbitrariness possible. And therefore needs, if not to be tweaked, many would say to be completely relooked at.
I don't know. What is the difference between relooking and tweaking?
My worry with tweaking is that it will be a small incremental change. I'm saying the changes need to be much more than incremental.
According to me, tweaking has not been a small incremental change.
So you're saying
it could be something more than a small incremental change.
Okay.
We have three types: district, high court, Supreme Court. We can reduce it to two, and the pendency will reduce at least 20%. I want your opinion on this. Reducing the right to appeal twice.
I don't know. Sir, I don't know. Supposing somebody says that there should be no appeal.
Yeah, the girl there was. No, she has that.
My name is Cheryl. Sir, the in-house mechanism is silent when there is a complaint against the Chief Justice. So what in your opinion is the correct framework or the ideal mechanism to deal with a complaint against the Chief Justice of India?
Well, I think this should be an in-house mechanism for everybody. Every judge, it doesn't matter if it's the Chief Justice or anybody else, they should be.
How has life changed between the chief, between your revolt, if I can use the word revolt?
No,
I won't use the word revolt. Between your statements of January 2018 when Justice Deepak Mishra was the Chief Justice and now Justice Gogoi. There's a sense, I'll be honest, there's a sense of disappointment among many people who thought that Justice Gogoi, being part of the four judges, would come as Chief Justice and would be a reformist judge. Instead, we're finding that Justice Gogoi seems to be stumbling from one controversy to another.
What do you want me to say?
Is there something about the office? Is there something about the office now that makes it necessarily controversial? Manish Chipper wrote a very good piece in the print where he says that, we criticized Justice Deepak Mishra and then we realized that whoever succeeds him actually is subject to even more criticism. Is that, I hope I've paraphrased it roughly what he was trying to say, that we don't know what lies next, but every Chief Justice sir seems to now increasingly find himself or herself in some controversy. Is that the nature of the office, you think?
I don't know. When I was Chief Justice of the High Court, I don't think there was any controversy.
The Chief Justice of the Supreme Court increasingly under the scanner now?
So is
the Chief Justice's role increasingly under the scanner? I think that's why she was also coming.
I think the role of everybody is under the scanner. Every judge, every Chief Justice, everybody is under the scanner.
And they should be under the scanner in your view?
Why not?
Including the Chief Justice?
Why not?
Because we saw what happened last year, sir, when impeached.
Regardless of what happened last year, are you trying to say that nobody should be under the scanner?
I'm saying everybody should be under.
I'm saying the same thing.
with a system that perhaps works more effectively to ensuring that being under the scanner ensures accountability.
Yeah, sure. Why not?
You have a suggestion?
Offhand, I don't have any suggestion. But yeah, listen, we are living in a free country. How can you say that nobody should be under a scanner or some people should not be under a scanner? Isn't that stretching things a little too far?
The reason, sir, is, and this I'm now talking as a journalist, over the last few years, we get reports about the top judge, the Chief Justice itself, judgments being passed a day before the judge retires, people saying they knew the judgment in that particular case in advance. Now, this could be gossip. But either way, the fact that these questions are raised about the highest judicial officer in the country doesn't trouble you.
Yeah, it does.
So you've also heard of them?
Well, everybody's heard of
them. Everybody's heard of them. Okay.
It's like this. If there is any allegation against a judge, it is bound to trouble. Right? And if there is substance in it, well, it is definitely a cause of concern.
Very quickly now.
Mr.
But do you have any particular other goals? Any post-retirement plans?
No, nothing for the time being. Post-retirement plans in the sense that I'm not going to work with any organization, government or whatever.
No government bungalow awaits.
No government bungalow awaits.
Okay, very quickly, Dinesh.
Yes. Sir, you are party to many of the judges' appointments. So what is your take on these IB reports? Because we have seen so many people recently appointed with certain political ideology and those who are very democratic and liberal at charge. So what is your take on this IB report?
Sorry, I didn't get
it. He's saying that the judicial appointments are now being made on the basis of ideology. Based on, and those ideologies are determined by IB reports. So he claims.
I'm not influenced by that at all.
Okay, the gentleman there, very quickly, yes ma'am. Last question.
Rajdeep,
one thing. Yeah, okay, one this side.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Sir, the way the present Chief Justice has been conducting the business, do you think another set of judges...
I'm not commenting.
Will come out or should come out and talk to the press?
I'm not commenting.
Okay, now it will become a press conference. Let's leave it there. Yes, the gentleman there. I hope you're not from the media. Are you from the media? Ah, okay, go ahead. We're terrible people, so don't ask. We are not supposed to ask questions. Go ahead.
The verdict is that the NJC judgment uses the respective reform that requires a glass loss and a perestroika. Why was the memorandum of procedure not pursued so enthusiastically as much enthusiasm of your right calling for these changes?
Not pursued enthusiastically by whom?
By the
I just mentioned that there was something like 11,000 pages different points of view. Some taking this side, some taking completely the opposite side. And that's one. So we don't have that kind of time for this. The second thing is the Attorney General said, and this is what had happened in the earlier Judge's case, that the memorandum of procedure was drafted by the government. So why should we take on the job which should have been done by the government?
Okay, maybe there are those young people, the girl and the boy, please ask short, quick questions.
Evening, sir. Just a quick question. Though the Constitution allows it, an academic has never been appointed to the Supreme Court as a judge. Why do you think that is?
I don't know.
Yes, the girl, I have a question. That's it? Great, wonderful. Yes, senior members of the bar.
Yes, go ahead. My question is, all the judges, I think everybody admits that Supreme Court is not right for all the judges. I don't think you should address me as my order.
My order is,
no, you should not. My question is very simple. Many judges, many CJIs, I think we're all also this view that Supreme Court is not right because it is right. It is right because it is final. Many times it happens, same set of evidence, same CRPC, same constitution, High Court gives different judgment and Supreme Court reverses it. And every time it is not right. Your Honor would agree to this, that every time it is not right. There are cases when even Supreme Court was wrong and High Court was right. And Justice Joseph, in fact, all his farewell functions, he talked of that sixth sense. Justice Lottie also talks of this divine power. And our Article 51A also talks of that spirit of inquiry. Are we doing something to improve spirit of inquiry for Supreme Court judges or so that they don't go wrong? The chances of doing their wrong are minimized. Are we doing something with that spirit? After all, it is constitution.
Yeah.
And every judge agrees, but I think the Lord also agrees that sometimes Supreme Court is wrong. So are we doing something?
We did have a retreat for the Supreme Court judges. I think it was a 2-day or a 3-day retreat, I'm not very sure. In the National Judicial Academy in 2017, I think. So, yeah, and before that also there was another retreat, so this was the second retreat. But yes, I think these kind of retreats should be more often. They should be.
So let me ask you one very selfish question. At the Editor's Guild, there's been this huge debate of going to the Supreme Court to strike down criminal defamation. Do you believe, you know, it's a law which has been struck off the statutes in Britain, where it originally came much, and we could even go into sedition. Do you believe the time has come to review some of these laws and strike them off?
Yeah, of course. There are so many laws that need to be...
Criminal defamation? Do you believe India should have a criminal defamation law?
I don't think so.
Sedition? In its present form as it exists, which can be... Well, I think a colonial law needs to be revised.
I think the Supreme Court has... said a lot about sedition and what constitutes sedition and what does not.
But at the end of the day, look at the way it's used, sir.
Yeah, but then look at the way murder is used. You know, sometimes somebody commits a murder and he's found it's not a murder. So that's a matter of interpretation.
But should it be reviewed or not?
It should be, yeah, of course, why not?
Okay, so criminal defamation struck off. Right? I wish you were the judge in that judgment. The person who gave the judgment later on became Chief Justice. That's why perhaps you didn't become Chief Justice. Which is another reason for another day. But give a very big hand to Justice of December 12th nonsense. Since you're in a thing and since you asked me that, you tell us that.
I don't know.
You don't know. That's what you told me when I asked you that earlier also. I said, well, when I asked you that, why was the recommendation of December 12th not uploaded on your resolution?
I don't know. I said that I'm disappointed.
You said you're disappointed. But I also asked you, is it true that you asked the Chief Justice the next day as to why it should be put up?
I did not. That's
okay, so you're effectively saying that you have never been, you still do not know the reasons why that particular recommendation of the collegium was not uploaded. You have no idea as of today.
None whatsoever.
Okay. And it leaves you disappointed, it leaves you let down. I'm trying to look for a stronger word than disappointment.
Disappointment.
Okay. Thank you very much.